Thank you very much for the lovely introduction. It's a great pleasure to be here today. I had a hard think about what to speak about today. And I thought I would start by simply playing some recorded music. And earlier you heard the aria from the Goldberg Variations as played by Glenn Gould in 1955. And now I will play you two versions of one of the movements of the Variations, one that was recorded in 1955 and one recorded in 1981. This was the young Glenn Gould.
He played very fast.
This is the older, more reflective Glenn Gould. So they are very different. They are the very same notes, the very same music, but he, the very same player, played it very differently. So what exactly is different about these two performances? So the point is to, I thought today I would talk about some of the things that make these differences apparent, and what are some of the things that we can listen out for, and what are the sources of these differences in different interpretations of the same piece of music. So I made a little video showing the difference, one difference of these two performances. This is in how you perceive, you might perceive the structures as they are implied in performance. So you might be hearing that because he's grouping things. You're hearing the bigger groups, and each time he's grouping them sort of bar by bar. And this is the later recording. And it's segmented very differently, or rather the intent is quite different. You may or may not agree with the segmentations I've put up there, but certainly he's accenting different things, and therefore he's guiding you to listen to different ways of parsing these notes. And we don't just do this in music, we do this in lots of other areas in life, like in speech. So this is an example from Julia Hirschberg. And this is a sequence of words. If you read it as it is, John doesn't drink because he's unhappy. So there are two ways to parse this. You could say, John doesn't drink because he's unhappy. Or, John doesn't drink because he's unhappy. They're completely different meanings. So in music, we can do the same things. And it is this perception, this way of perceiving the same thing in different ways that allows us to have different interpretations of music, allows performers to have different interpretations of music, allows listeners to have different interpretations of what is communicated in a performance. And so this leads me to the agenda for today. I'm going to talk about three things, only three things, so you can keep me to this. One is the duality principle, two is the spiral array model, and three is tipping points. And all of them have something to do with the kind of work that is involved in making music. So we'll start with the duality principle. I won't say what it is first, we'll get into it. I will show you three analyses of performances that were created with the help of an interactive improvisation system called MIMI. MIMI stands for Multimodal Interactive Musical Improvisation. And MIMI is a system that was designed in my lab. It was a project led by Alexandre Francois. And it's been used in performances by improvisers and composers. And these are three performances that were created by a composer slash improviser, Isaac Schenkler. And these are three different analyses, ways of segmenting this performance by, in the top half, that's the performer, Isaac Schenkler. And below, that's an intelligent listener, but not the performer, Jordan Smith. So two different people listened to the same recorded performance and had two different views or hearings of what was projected in the performance. So what could be the reason for these very different hearings of the very same recording? So we'll take a look quickly at one, maybe two examples. So pay attention when this is played. Is to this part here, where Isaac had A1 and B1, that's part of a big letter A1, and Jordan thought this was just all one little A1 that's part of a larger big A1. Okay, so were you paying attention to the top or lower one? Doesn't matter. This time we'll listen to it again. Pay attention to the other one that you were not paying attention to before. So Isaac and Jordan were asked to talk to each other and figure out why they thought about this same thing so differently. So they were comparing their analyses, and one was thinking of it in terms of straight eighth notes, which means that they were thinking of it like this. Straight, straight, straight. And the other person was thinking of it in terms of triplets. So if you're thinking of it in terms of triplets, you would never put a boundary here halfway through a triplet. So it's a matter of interpreting what is being heard. And so as we were seeing these differences unfold over the different interpretations of the structure of the three different performances, the structure is quite different in the two, we collected the reasons for the differences in the way they were listening to the music. They could be paying attention to different features in the music, the rhythm versus the harmony, versus which instrument was playing, or difference in expectation. Jordan was thinking, well, I think that all sections should be roughly the same size because I've annotated a lot of popular music and they tend to be all similar in size. And so that was one assumption that didn't quite fit Isaac's version of the structure in the piece. Another difference came from the level of information One was the performer, one was a listener. So the performer had sort of insight information about what he was trying to do. And ontological commitments, this is an interesting one. So depending on what you labeled as an A or little A, or what you label as a little B, that completely defines what the rest of your analysis was. And if you labeled different A's and B's, you come up with different analyses. And so these were some of the findings from that set of experiments. So this led us to think that, well, maybe people are just doing it all wrong in terms of computational music analysis. So a lot of computational music analysis is often having to do with structure, different structures of music. And music structure doesn't just relate to large scale form, it also relates to tonal structure, rhythmic structure, so structures at all different hierarchical levels. So often, music structure analysis with computers is done where you take for granted this is the music content, the music data. Given this music data, what is the analysis that we can get out of the data? And so this means that one set of data, if you have the stream of information, and it's the same stream of information, then you should get the same result, the same analysis from that information stream. And this does not seem to be the case for music. This is quite different. And so we decided to basically turn the convention on its head. This doesn't work for music, because depending on who's listening to it, depending on who's playing, all these other factors affects what the analysis actually is. So the analysis is not the result of the music content, rather, the analysis is the result of the listener's hearing, and the listener includes the performer, because the performer has to have a hearing and a vision of what that music actually is before they can actually convey it. So it's the a function of the listener's hearing of the music content. So this changed the way in which we were actually approaching the problem of computational music analysis. Rather than starting with the music data, we start with an analysis. So if we have an analysis that maybe might look like this for the Beatles' Yellow Submarine, then you go back and you look at the recording or the score, and you go, these are how the different features in the music are changing. And if we look at the different features and how they're changing, and we compare that with the analysis and where the segmentation boundaries are, we can then deduce what might the listener might have been paying attention to at this point to decide that there's actually a boundary here. So then the listener might, if there's a boundary at this point for maybe rhythm and not so much harmony and timbre, then maybe the listener was paying attention to the rhythm rather than the other things. Yes. Oh, yes. This is the time in time. This is a similarity matrix. So it's the correlation of any two windows, I and J. Yeah. Okay, so if we think of the problem in this way, then we can reconstruct an analysis. That's a reconstruction. That's a reconstruction of that. That's a reconstruction of that. To try to explain how someone came up with an explanation of a structure of a piece of music. Okay, so that basically is the duality bit of the talk. So it talks about how we turn the problem around. We look at a dual problem rather than the original primal problem. In order to be able to explain parts, an understanding of music rather than an understanding of the data. Okay, so why are parsings and analyses of music structure so important? They're important because they have to do with music communication. And I will show a little bit what you can do when you know how to play around with structure. So this is Happy Birthday. Everybody knows Happy Birthday. I will actually sing it, so you'll forgive me, I'm not a singer. Happy birthday to you. Da 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 da. Oh, okay, all right, thank you. Okay, so I could do that and cause an uncomfortable feeling in your gut because you know it was not finished and it had to finish. Okay, this is playing with music structure. And you can do the same when you play around with a sequence that's maybe more abstract than Happy Birthday. This is one of the Bach fugue themes. It's ambiguous, but depending on where you stop and take more time, I can force you to hear other keys other than the F sharp minor that it's in. So if I stop at these boundaries, minor, but I've made you hear something far richer than the first, just by taking time and making you pay attention to other things. So you can do that because of the structures in music that's called tonality. And one of my earliest work in computational music analysis was the discovery of a model called the spiral array model. The spiral array is based on something that's very well known and dates back a long time, hundreds of years, to Euler. And it's based on something called the harmonic network, also known as the tonets. And if you look at the tonets, on the horizontal axis are things that are related by fifths. Things related by fifths have a rough 2-to-3 frequency ratio. And vertically, we have things related by thirds. And that has a roughly 4-to-5 frequency ratio relationship. And if you stare at this long enough, you'll think, gee, well, the D repeats. Yeah, there's a D here and there's a D there. Why don't we wrap it up? In the good old days of transparencies, so you would take the two Ds, you roll it up, and you put the Ds over each other, and you'll end up with a shape that looks like this. End up with a helical model. Helical configuration of the original tonets. And the nice thing about the 3D model is that now we're no longer in a flat plane. We're now in 3D. In 3D, this means that this nice plane that's wrapped around the cylinder now has an inside space, an interior, that we can play with. So that's this interior space. So what can we do with the interior space? Things that are closely related are going to be closely clustered in this space. So we still have the fifths and thirds forming these nice triads. So all the triads also wrap itself, they wrap themselves around the cylinder, and we can represent every single triangle with a single dot on the triangle. And if we connect the dots, we get another helix. So we get an inner helix, that's the major triad spiral. And three adjacent triangles are a fifth apart. So let's say you're at C, a fifth above is that, the G. And this is the C, a fifth below is the F. So we've got all the triads we need to harmonize any melody in that key of C. And so the key is uniquely defined by those three adjacent triads. So again, we can connect three adjacent dots to get a triangle and get lots of triangles going up this way. And if we, again, represent each triangle as a point on the triangle, then we can connect the dots again and get a further inner helix that represents all the major keys. So this is how we construct the major keys. And we can similarly, in a very similar way, do the same to get a minor key helix, minor triad helix. And so we have a series of helices that are nested inside each other to form these representations. So the nice thing about nesting all of these representations is that we can then compare things that are at different hierarchical levels, because pitch classes are at the lowest level, and when we get three of them together, we get triads, and we get three triads together, we get keys. So these are actually hierarchically different, but because they're in the same 3D space, we can now compare them and measure distances between objects that are at different hierarchical levels. So if we have, one more thing to say before we move on to an example. Things that are in the same key, these are the three triangles here, now mapped to this. It's a compact space. And if you get all the points that represent the pitches in that key, then you wrap a net around it, you get the convex hull of those points, you have this space here that represents a key. So if we have a melody, a popular tune, and if you have something like this, think of me fondly. So when we said goodbye, okay, so you've got the melody here, and you've got all the notes. You can map all the notes over here and generate the center of gravity of the notes. And that summary point represents the spatially where this melody is operating. And if we're interested in the key of the melody, we simply look for the closest key in the key spirals. The key spirals, the major and minor key helices, actually form this double helix shape in the interior of the space. And so we simply look on those two helices for the closest key representation. And we can do this gradually as information accumulates. So in this case, think of me fondly when we said goodbye. Okay, so then you can say, well, at this point, I want to find out what is the closest key. You generate the center, and you look for the closest key, and you've identified the closest key, and therefore you have a way of automatically detecting key. If you're interested in more local keys rather than a cumulative global key, you have other strategies of having smaller windows or cutting to a new key for getting. So those are different strategies for being able to analyze key on the fly. So this algorithm and model has been implemented in MuseArt, which is an interactive software for real-time tonal analysis, which I'm going to cut out to right now. All right. Here's the C major triad. I'll do a simple. So we have the C major triad showing us a triangle, and there's a rhombus around the key. It's labeled as C. So that's the closest key that's on the inner double helices, and it's labeled on the outside with the rhombus. Triad's D minor, but in the key of C still. The triad's now G major, key of C. Triad is A minor. The closest triad is D major and G, yeah? Okay, so this is how it works. might take a look at how it works for unusual pieces like PDQ Bach. PDQ Bach is the forgotten son of J.S. Bach that is alive today. Short tempered clavier, prelude in C, based on what you just heard. Thank you. And it's going to swing low. Okay, when it goes in other places. Here's another example. This is Beethoven's Fifth. Okay, and this is the point where it's not supposed to do that. It's supposed to go, but when. So that's why it's going way up there, because it's not in the key. So something that's unexpected. So I've been showing you examples that are tonally unexpected. They will do things like swinging, going really far out of reach. Something that's expected. So this is an example of variations. Those are simple chords, but now if we do something more elaborate. Traces the same path, but sort of slightly more jagged because arranged, and this one even more. Okay, so it's, I'm not going to try to finish that. But so it does even more, and because it's really fast, it's doesn't have as much time to go as far, but you can see that it's sort of jittering around there. So in this program, you can set the windows because the memory is different. Chords are a more local phenomenon, so the window's smaller for the chords, or the forgetting function is faster. And keys last longer, so the forgetting function is slower. Different pieces of music change at different rates, so you want the analyses to at different, also adjust the speeds to accommodate the piece that you actually have. I didn't change any of the settings, I just took the default. Are very much in the classical form and using tonality. So you heard the PDQ Bach. Are the violations of expectations when it swings down south. Okay, so as Daniel mentioned earlier, most of this work has been described in a Springer publication on mathematical and computational modeling of tonality. And since that publication, we've done a bit of extra work on modeling of tonal tension. Because as you saw earlier, that when it does something unexpected and therefore can cause tension, like I did with the happy birthday example, then it's sort of pulling away. It's kind of an elasticity when you try to move away from the center, and there is a force that sort of makes you want to. That causes a feeling of tension. So there are different kinds of tension, one based on how widely spread the pitches are. And so if something's really widespread and it's using lots of pitches over a large space, it's very dissonant. So that causes tension. If something's moving far away from what the global or the local key is, then that causes tension because you want to come back to it. And also, if you're moving a lot in the space really fast, that also causes tension. So these are examples of tension-causing devices, or modeled as cloud diameter, which is a spread, tensile strain pulling away from the center, and cloud momentum moving around inside the space. And here's an example of what the three values look like for the Tristan chord. Here's an example of what the third value looks like for the Schubert example. Next value is really high. So that's where you can cause that feeling of tension. Okay, so that's the second topic. So that's Musart, the spiral array model. And we move on to the third topic of tipping points. And this has to do with taking time. And when you take a lot of time, like in the happy birthday example, okay, so that's a tipping point. You want that to come back, right? And so that's an effect. That's an effect that is used not a whole lot, but it's used very effectively in communication of music and music performance. And why is it called a tipping point? Because we all know about tipping points. We know about the physics of tipping points. And in, oh, this is an example. All experimented with tipping points from a very young age, and therefore we know how it works. And in a lot of music, the timing of events and how it is spaced out has sort of physical analogies in the real world, often physiological. And in this case, the tipping point is one that we're very familiar with, and it's one that is invoked a lot in music. Okay, well, he just lost the tower. Okay, so in physics, this is an example. Well, this is the definition of tipping points, when the center of gravity moves past that point at which you then tip over. We also have social tipping points. So we all know about thresholds beyond which, you know, you can't return. We also have popular tipping points. We know about tipping points in many different realms, and so why not in music? In music, this is even more close to the physics definition of tipping points. And a timeless moment of suspended stillness. You experience that with a happy birthday. And so we can all do that, and we can cause people to have that feeling of tension. Sopranos and tenors are very good at this. This is an example by Maria Callas. And she's going to sing these words on the right, and in red are the points where she takes a lot of time. Thank you. You might not just want to take my word for it that she took time. We can measure it. And this is how much time she and other sopranos took. If the average eighth note was taking half a second, at the points when they were taking time, at that point, up there, Kiri Takanawa was taking over 5 seconds. Yeah. That's a tenfold increase from half a second to over five seconds. This is how much time they actually take. I mean, forget about metronomes. Metronomes don't work with this kind of music. Actually, are very free. Well, in some ways, very free. But in other ways, you'll see they're taking time at similar places. So there are points at which you can take time and points where you can't. Like Happy Birthday, I could take time at the point where you know more was to come. But if I took time anywhere else or other places, it could really fall flat and you wouldn't stay around to listen for it. And so there's right ways to do this and there are wrong ways to do this. Now that you've seen these tipping points shown by the cue balls, this is in score time so that I could put the score underneath and you can see where the notes align with the measurements. But in order to hear this and see this at the same time, you have to see this in real time, which is in performance time. And so this has been stretched out in performance time. I didn't stretch the score. So there's no score here, just the measurements. Okay, so you notice there's two cue balls in the first two. There's no cue ball in the third one. I didn't put one there because it didn't have that feeling of tension. So it's not just the time, it's also the placement, what notes are happening at that time, and where in the music this is happening. A very well-known writer, Leonard Meyer, in his book, Emotion and Meaning in Music, wrote that the emotional content of music arises mainly from the composer's, through the composer's choreography of expectation. But you see in these examples that it is also the performer's choreography and manipulation of expectation. One larger example and one quick example. This one is Martha Argerich playing Strauss Burlesque. And this is at the end of the cadenza, or near the end of the cadenza. In the concerto, there's a cadenza part where the soloist gets to show off. And at the end of the cadenza, then the orchestra comes back with the main theme, and so it's the point of return. And at that point of return, you can often take huge amounts of time because people know that the return is coming. And so this is what you will see here. Thank you. we've been waiting for that moment. And that is what makes it so beautiful when it comes. She's not the only one who does that. Very different players. Ben Gould, whom you heard at the beginning, and Richter. They all take a lot of time at that last one. Yes, there's a build-up to it. And this is Martha Argerich again, this time with the data. So that A keeps coming back. And finally, just to show that tipping points don't occur at these massive scales only. This is a massive scale tipping point. This is seismic. Here, we're going to see one with small local tipping points. This is Chrysler playing Schön Rose Marin. And if you like, you can tap along to this just to see how much he's varying the tempo. Okay. All right. Anyone tried that? How did you do? Okay, ready to see the data? Yes. Okay, this is what he did. He's quite cheeky because he started with taking a lot of time on the first note. I mean, who does that? And the first note has to continue, so you're waiting for him to continue, and he can sort of da, 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 yeah? And so this is how he does it in... Oh, I didn't put the video here. I wasn't planning to show it. Okay, so you get the idea. Yeah, so this is tipping points in Chrysler, and it's online. And with regard to tipping points, we've mentioned they're global ones, they're local ones. Often where they occur is when expectation is peaked, even in the Chrysler example, if you go back to it. Oops. And that's where he's taking time. Yeah, sorry. You need to do that on a violin. So he's taking time at points where you're expecting not just melodically for the registral return, you're also expecting tonally for it to return to a point that's more stable. So tipping points occur when expectation is at its peak, but also information is minimized because you know what's coming, what has to happen next. And a lot of it can be explained by tonal expectations. It can also be explained by melodic expectations, and this work is described in a music perception article in a special issue that was part of the 25-year celebration of the publication of three major books in music cognition. And with that, I'll give you the list of references if you want to read more. And I want to thank all the people who have helped with the work that I've shown, the different projects. And if you're interested in reading more, there's I have three different blogs and a website, so you can find out more about the research as well as the performance aspects of the work.
And finally, we'll just finish and I'll take questions.
We go back to the 1981 version of the aria. Thank you.